Kind thanks go to Brilliant for sponsoring today's episode. Today, amongst other things, I'll explain to you what NASA has in store for SpaceX's Starships and how SpaceX will manage to make the upcoming Crew 1 flight even safer for our brave astronauts.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Looks like it's handled.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix and I am your host for today's episode of What About It? And as always, there has been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship updates. It's been a few days since our last update on SpaceX's progress in Boca Chica again, and usually that's more than enough time for Elon Musk and his crew to get the usual insane amount of progress done. Starship draws all the attention, and rightfully so. What SpaceX is building in Boca Chica, Texas right now is just mind-boggling to say the least. What you see here are some snippets from a long-term project Eric, one of my very talented 3D artists, and I are working on right now. This is what I call serial number X. It's the first Starship to actually fly a mission, carry a payload, and start something many will refer to as the moment we finally acquired the means to settle in space. Not just projects like the proposed Mars colony. Starships will enable us to increase the amount of payload delivered to orbit per year, maybe by a hundredfold or more. And it's not only us dreaming big right now. This, for example, is a render released by NASA on October 1st, so just a few days ago. Anything that's released by NASA can be called official. Made by Icon, a construction technologies company based in Austin, Texas, working for NASA and developing 3D printing technologies right now, it shows a scene right out of a Hollywood blockbuster. A rather large moon base with all sorts of infrastructure. To the right, we can see storage and habitation buildings. On the hills to the far left, we can see something that vaguely looks like observatories. In the middle, the scene is dominated by three large launch and landing pads surrounded by a ring wall supposed to contain engine blasts. There are multiple research teams right now from all around the planet working on similar technology. On the left pad, we can see the printing process in progress. Pad number 3 is still being built. This is what a foundation base could look like. Once these three pads and the surrounding infrastructure are done, multiple flights per day could commence with a system like SpaceX's Starship. And if we focus our attention on the landed Starship itself, a few more interesting facts are revealed. First of all, it still shows an old Starship design. Judging by the forward flaps, it's closer to Mark 1 than what we see today. There's one other very interesting aspect about it, though. It does not show the famous Lunar Starship. Seen here in one of Caspar Stanley's awesome animations done for What About It, the Lunar Starship is a special variant in development by SpaceX and partly funded for and by NASA. It solves one big problem Starships have regarding the moon. Raptor engines produce too much thrust when decelerating Starships for touchdown on the lunar surface. This would cause lunar regolith to be slung out in a gigantic radius around the landing site, and in an extreme case, it could even lead to lunar surface material being catapulted into an orbit around the moon. In theory, it could even reach Earth. The Lunar Starship, though, solves this problem by utilizing engines further up on the hull, creating more distance between the descent engines and the surface. Besides this, the Lunar Starship also is not capable of landing on Earth again. It's missing flaps and heat shield, which are not needed on the moon due to lack of an atmosphere. Well, technically, our moon has an atmosphere. It's just so thin that it's called an exosphere. Composed of only 100 molecules per cubic centimeter. Its total weight is around 25,000 kilograms and it's spread out so thin that the gas molecules rarely collide with each other. In short, a heat shield and flaps would not make any sense on the moon. So NASA has come up with the Lunar Starship as a means of transferring cargo and later crew between their proposed lunar gateway and the surface. On Icon's illustration though, we can see a normal Earth-based Starship. And it makes sense too. Once there are landing and takeoff pads on the moon's surface, it would enable SpaceX to send standard Starships to the moon directly from Earth, rendering a stop at a lunar gateway obsolete. And since this render was released by NASA, it very well might show a possible future. Again, Icon is working on tech needed to build what you see in the illustration as you watch this episode. A link to the NASA announcement is in the description so you can read on after the episode. Big thanks as always go out to Caspar and Eric for providing me with these absolutely stunning 3D renders. Go follow them on Twitter for more. Links are in the description. This is just one of many possible scenarios we can look forward to once SpaceX's prototype phase is complete and Starships are taking flight on a regular schedule. And SpaceX is making progress towards just that. After lifting the latest prototype, Starship Serial Number 8, onto one of the two stands a few days ago, workers prepared it for testing. The flaps got fixed in place. Last preparations were done on top of Serial Number 8 and something got lifted down with a crane. It's impossible to make out what exactly it was. If you have any idea, tell me in the comments, I'd love to know your thoughts. An ambient pressure test was performed to make sure that there is no obvious leak on the tanks. The end of the ambient pressure test was signaled by venting, which can clearly be seen on Lab Padre's cam. His stream's by far the best source for live views of what's going on in Boca Chica, Texas. Make sure to check out his channel, link is in the description. Now everything should be set for a cryogenic test coming up next, and after this we should see a nose cone being stacked and forward flaps installed. Then Raptors and the first ever static fire utilizing three engines at the same time, and we're ready for liftoff. I'm going on a short vacation until the 18th from tomorrow on, so I'll be skipping the next three episodes. If SpaceX decides to do the Serial Number 8 flight before I return though, you can be very sure that I'll make an exception for that and watch it happen together with you on my channel. At the construction site, the high bay is being fleshed out more and more. Roof elements are being installed. Less and less is missing each time I do an update. And the roof structure looks very strong. We might see a ceiling crane being installed here in the end. Serial Number 9's tank section has been completely stacked in the midbay. This is Starship Serial Number 8's backup. If Serial Number 8 craters and has a spectacular ending to its first flight, Starship Serial Number 9 will be able to take over without much delay and continue the flight campaign. Serial Number 11 is coming along as well. What you're looking at here is its forward header tank to be installed in the very tip of the nose cone. When done, it will store fuel needed for landing to make sure that the engines always have fuel even when a belly flop maneuver is being performed. All these pictures out of Mary's camera lens. Make sure to check out her work for NASA spaceflight on the NSF forums. And there's one takeaway from the Serial Number 7.1 tests I want to mention as well. Right before taking it down from the test stands, rather rudely, SpaceX workers cut out the hatch from the hull. While tests were going on, a leak could be observed on the right side. This likely was caused by the hatch. SpaceX has cut it out after the tests to perform a thorough analysis of what caused the leak. This is a perfect example for an iterative design process. Step by step, the prototypes are being analyzed and improved over time. Last but not least for today's Starship update, I want to give you a quick overview of what's going on at the launch site right now. And what better to use for this than Mauricio's awesome bird's eye view? Make sure to follow him on Twitter and consider becoming a flight supporter on his Patreon page. The more fuel money he gets, the more pictures he can provide. Besides Serial Number 7.1 still being on the test stand here and Starship Serial Number 8 being prepared for its test campaign, we can also see a few other very interesting developments. The truck parade has started again. The trucks are needed for yet another large-scale terrain grading project. It's kind of obvious what SpaceX workers are doing here right now. They're preparing the ground for building work. The more interesting question to me is what they are planning to build here. What's still missing? Some sort of water reservoir is still missing for sound suppression purposes? Maybe a water tower? A high bay, in my opinion, would make a lot of sense too. Musk spoke about stacking of Starships on top of boosters would likely be a limiting factor in launch cadence. So it would make sense to have some sort of garage close to the launch mount. You can park Starships and boosters for stacking. Also mentioned by Musk before, an engine stand is still missing too. Whatever SpaceX is planning here, it won't be long now until we know. What can also be seen is a trench leading from the fuel farm all the way past Starhopper. Is this the still missing connection between fuel farm and orbital launch mount? Like the episode so far? Then make sure to subscribe, hit the like button, and consider becoming a patron to give some vital support. Your support makes all this possible in the first place. And if you want to show the world that you're a fan of What About It and Rockets, check out our merch store and dress differently. It's full of designs made to fill your closets and drawers with awesome shirts, hoodies, zippers, jackets, base caps, cups, bags, you get the idea. Every sale supports the channel, links are in the description. You rock. The end of the year still has a few very historic moments in stock for all of us. A Starship flight to 15 kilometers with serial number 8, yet another Starship presentation where Elon Musk will unveil the final design of Starships going forward, and the first ever certified Crew Dragon launch. Crew 1 preparing for liftoff. NASA and SpaceX has something special planned for this year's Halloween. Crew 1, the first official routine flight of a SpaceX Crew Dragon to the ISS, is closing in fast. May 30, 2020. SpaceX Demo 2 takes off towards the International Space Station. The first ever commercial crew vehicle to do the trip with an actual crew on board. Douglas Hurley and Robert Behnken did it, demonstrating that SpaceX is capable of delivering humans to space and to the ISS. Docking on May 31st, staying for 62 days, 9 hours and 8 minutes, undocking and making their way back down to Earth, splashing down in the Gulf of Mexico. Endeavour, as the Crew Dragon was named, went straight into the history books, marking the beginning of orbital human spaceflight on privately built commercial spacecrafts. Now, NASA and SpaceX are almost done certifying Crew Dragon and moving it into regular service. Demo 2 was not just a shiny presentation. It was also the final test for the space vehicle itself. Vital data was collected again, and a few aspects have been found that still need improvements before the first regular crew rotation flight and the culmination of many years of work can commence. Comprised of an international team with NASA astronauts Michael Hopkins, Victor Glover, Shannon Walker, and Soichi Noguchi of the Japanese Aerospace Exploration Agency, or JAXA, Crew 1 is set to launch from Launch Complex 39A at Kennedy Space Center on October 31st. It marks the return of a full crew complement to the International Space Station, bringing the team up to 7 astronauts again. Named Resilience to symbolize the will to proceed with human exploration even in a year like 2020, Crew 1 also is right on time to celebrate the 20th anniversary of continuous human presence on board the ISS, which started with Exploration 1 on November 2nd in the year 2000. There are 5 vital improvements done to Resilience compared to Endeavour to make it ready for crew. 1. The ability to switch ports on the ISS. Since there might be the chance that a Boeing Starliner arrives at the space station while Resilience is docked, it will have to switch docking ports. For this, astronauts will enter the capsule and run a new set of software to change docking ports from the forward port to the Zenith port. The flight will be autonomous with the crew monitoring the process. 2. An improved heat shield. Once Behnken and Hurley were back on Earth, an investigation revealed that one of the heat shield's tiles suffered a little bit more erosion than we expected to see, as Hans Koenigsmann, Vice President of Build and Flight Reliability at SpaceX, put it. The astronauts, though, were safe at all times during the flight, and the vehicle worked perfectly. What you're looking at here is Endeavour's heat shield after splashdown. In the corners, you can see the connector openings for the spacecraft's trunk. While in space, tension ties are attached between the capsule and the trunk to keep it in place. While re-entering the atmosphere, unexpected vortexes formed, eating into the heat shield more than anticipated. Resilience's heat shield has been reinforced in these particular spots to give extra safety margin. 3. Barometric sensor improvements. While Demo 2 was on its final descent, a barometric sensor was supposed to control when the capsule deploys its first 2 parachutes. This happened a little late due to the filter supposed to clean the air running into the sensor being clogged. The deployment happened within limits though, and again, the astronauts were in no danger at any time. The particular filter now has been opened up a bit to prevent this from happening again. 4. Solar panel improvements. Endeavour would not have been able to stay docked with the ISS for the full duration of Crew 1's mission. The new capsule will have to stay docked with the ISS for 6 months. To make this possible, the solar panels have been improved to withstand space weather and the radiation for up to 210 days. 5. Operation Clean Sea. So, the last point on the improvements list has nothing to do directly with the Crew Dragon. Remember this scene from the Demo 2 splashdown site? Those boats are not part of SpaceX's or NASA's recovery fleet. Those are spectators. What were these people thinking, getting so close to a vital operation of recovering a freshly returned spacecraft, including crew? Whoever was part of this should be ashamed, to say the least. To prevent this from happening again, NASA and SpaceX intend to set up a 10-mile no-boat perimeter for the Crew 1 splashdown. No more spectating with political statements. Crew 1 will be the first regular flight, the first of many to come, and during its stay at the ISS we might even see Boeing attempt their first trip with a Starliner capsule towards our permanent low Earth orbit habitat. SpaceX is ushering in a new era of spaceflight not only in Boca Chica, Texas. Crew Dragon is ready for business. In the next 14 months there will always be a Dragon docked to the ISS, and in the same time frame there are 7 NASA missions planned with Dragon vehicles. I am very much ready to witness all of it together with you. Doing the engineering work for such important projects is a long-term process that involves constant learning. If you're interested in learning new things to improve your STEM skills, today's sponsor is the perfect place to start. Brilliant is a problem-solving based website and app with a hands-on approach. With over 60 interactive courses in math, science, and computer science, Brilliant helps you to achieve your goals in STEM, starting with one small commitment to learning and building up to a long-term challenge and growth. One of Brilliant's top courses is about chemistry. Here you can learn all about the substances of which matter is composed. The investigation of their properties and reactions and the use of such reactions to form new substances can be incredibly interesting. The Sabatier process, for example, is just one of many processes that might shape our future. This is just one example of all the courses on Brilliant. Brilliant puzzles you, surprises you, and expands your understanding of the modern world. All of Brilliant's courses have storytelling, code writing, interactive challenges, and problems to solve. To learn things the Brilliant way and at the same time support What About It, go to brilliant.org/whataboutit and sign up to try out over 60 interactive courses for free. And if you choose to get the premium subscription, the first 200 people to join through the link will get 20% off the annual premium subscription. Learn new things the Brilliant way. Links in the description. Today's YouTube member and Patreon shoutout goes to William Contino, Patrick Henners, DJJ Dynamike, Semi Oscuro, Ken May, See Ya Later Navigator, Kevin L. Scott, Mark S. Held, Sebastian Brummer, David Watkins, and many others. You rock! My team and I are humbled every time one of you hits our Discord, and I can't stress enough how much you people help us in creating episode after episode. If you want to be part of the innermost core of the community too, chat with me and others on our voice channels, and maybe even be part of the team that helps create the show you like, consider becoming a patron or YouTube member by clicking the link in the description or the join button right under this video. Thank you so much! The latest words are for the team. Today I want to thank Julia for taking over a few very vital functions in the background. It's one of those positions where the results are not obvious. There's no shiny new 3D animation involved. There's no new sponsor or interview making the next show the next milestone for the channel. She's keeping our books straight, and without that, none of what I just mentioned would even be possible. So thank you, Julia, for taking this silent position and being very, very important for all of us on the team. You rock. There's a starship flying overhead. Sure that I'll make it, you can be very sure that I'll never be able to read this. SpaceX has cut out, hey SpaceX, what the hell are you doing? Step by step, come on. Is this?
Perimeter.
So what's going on? Okay, come on. Okay, contenance, English, you know?